Okay, so today's class discussion, okay, the continuation of the RAID technology. Okay, so let me quickly go through what we discussed in the previous class. So I had mentioned that RAID is a technology which has adopted to support the increasing demand for storage capacity and performance. Okay, so the compared to the single large expensive drive, so we are going to have been adopting the RAID technology. Fine. So we started. So RAID stands for redundant array of either inexpensive disk or independent disk drive. So both way we can term it. So we discussed the RAID implementation method. Hardware RAID and software RAID, we differentiated. Okay, software RAID uses the host-based software to provide RAID functions, whereas the hardware RAID, a specialized hardware controller is implemented either on the host or on the array. Correct. So I'll go to the presentation. Okay. Sorry. So I'll show the slide here. So I have shown you the hardware RAID, how it looks here. So the first diagram I have shown you. Okay, the RAID array components. Okay, so you can see here okay, so that is the techniques, RAID techniques. So before that, I showed you the first. I'll show you here. Okay. So RAID implementation hardware, yeah, this is the diagram, RAID array components. So you can see host is the RAID array. RAID array is nothing but enclosure which contains a number of disk drives and supporting hardware to implement RAID. Okay, so you can see here a subset of the disk within a RAID array, either it can be grouped to form logical associations called logical arrays. Okay, it is also known as RAID set or RAID group. So this is the components of a RAID array. So you can see between the host and the collection of the hard disk, we have the RAID controller. Okay, so that is the implementation part. Next, we discussed the major, the three major techniques, RAID techniques. And based upon that, we have discussed the concept of the RAID levels. So the first one is stripping. I told it is a what is RAID generally is a collection of the multiple disks. So we are going the predefined number of contiguously addressable disk blocks, we call them as a strip, and collection of such strips in an aligned fashion is called as a stripe. So you can see here, this is what I showed you, I call as the stripping technique. You can observe here, so first strip, second strip, third strip. So they are all aligned, so I can call this collection as a stripe. Then mirroring, I told mirroring is very simple. Why it is used? To get a mirror copy of the disk which you want to protect, and in this way you have two copies of the data. Supposing in case of failure, the controller will use the second disk to serve the data. So that's how making the data availability continuous. So I told the data. Okay, so data availability part. Okay, so fine. So data availability should be continuous. So for that, so the mirroring concept can be used. You can see here both disks are identical, disk one, disk two, but it will be more expensive. Why? Because you are simply having a duplicate set of the data. The third one is called parity. I told generally it is for error detection correction. Okay, so it is reliable and low cost solution for data protection. So I showed you that it is a redundancy check that ensures full protection of the data without maintaining full set of the duplicate. You need not maintain full set of the duplicate data. So you can see here I have three disks are there. The fourth one can be a parity disk. Correct. So three dedicated hard disk drives are there. So the parity information can be stored on a separate distributed across separate dedicated hard disk drive, and which is distributed across all the drives. Okay, the first three disks will contain the data, the fourth disk stores the parity information. So it is nothing but the sum of the elements in each row. suppose one of the disk fails, the missing value can be calculated by subtracting the sum of the rest of the elements from the parity value. So we are going to make use of the XOR operation. Okay. So this is the three major techniques we discussed. Okay. So based on that, so now we started discussing the RAID levels, right? So the okay. Okay, we started discussing the RAID levels, that is the RAID 0, RAID 1, then we have the RAID set, okay, so this is stripping, then mirroring, then this is the parity. Okay, with that we have, I told the XOR operation, we are going to make use of this. Okay, so advantages is that compared to mirroring, parity implementation is reduces the cost. Of course, disadvantage is that parity information is generated from the data on the data disk. Therefore, parity has to be recalculated every time there is a change in the data. Okay. So, the RAID levels, this is more very, very important. RAID levels. Okay. So, generally, it is the selection of the RAID level is determined by the following factors: application performance, data availability requirement, and cost. So the first one is very simple, RAID level 0, then RAID level 1, next is nested. So next, RAID 3, 4, 5, 6. RAID 0, it uses data stripping technique. So where the data is stripped across all the disk within a RAID set. Therefore, it will utilize the full storage capacity of a RAID set. Okay. The diagram you can see here, I have already shown you in the last class, RAID level 0. It basically uses a stripping technique. So when the number of drives increases, naturally the performance will improve because more data can be read or written simultaneously. RAID level 0 is a good option for applications that need high input-output throughput. Okay. Next is RAID level 1. RAID level 1 is based on the mirroring technique. So data is mirrored to provide fault tolerance. Okay, so it consists of two disk drives and every write is returned to both disks. The mirroring is transparent to the host. So if the disk fails, the impact on the data recovery is least. Correct. So that is the difference between RAID level 0 and RAID level 1. Okay, RAID level 0, it is used. It does not protect, the limitation is that it does not provide data protection and availability, but of course it is a good option for the applications that require high input-output throughput. Whereas RAID level 1, it supports data availability, that is nothing but protection. Correct? Why? Because if any disk fails, the impact on the data recovery is very least. Why? Because it uses the mirror drive for data recovery. So whenever there is a cost is not a constraint and high availability is required, then you can go for RAID level 1. Next is what, you can see the diagram. RAID level 1, already we discussed it. The next is the nested RAID. Nested RAID. Okay, so we have sometimes we require data redundancy and performance, both types. So we have two types, they call it as nested 1 plus 0, and next one is nested 0 plus 1. Okay, so both will combine the performance benefits of RAID 0 with the redundancy benefits of RAID 1. Okay, so this type of implementation requires even number of disk. Okay, the minimum 4. Okay, so I'll go to the slide what I had shown you here in the previous classes. Okay, so then we'll go to the RAID level 3. So this one we have seen, RAID level 1. RAID level 1 I showed you. Okay, let me start with RAID level 0. You can see here RAID level 0. Okay, so this is nothing but the stripping technique. You can observe here, this is RAID level 0. RAID level 1, you can observe here. Okay, it is a, you can observe that it is a parity technique. sorry, mirroring technique. RAID level 1 uses a mirroring technique. Fine. Now can okay, see it can. So it is simply a mirroring. Okay. Now the nested RAID, we have either RAID 1 plus 0 and RAID 0 plus 1. So 1 plus 0 is called as a striped mirror, whereas 0 plus 1 is known as a mirrored stripe. So RAID 1 plus 0, we can also write as RAID 1 0 or RAID 1 slash 0. Whereas RAID 0 plus 1, we can write as RAID 0 1 or RAID 0 slash 1. Okay. So the RAID 1 plus 1 performs well for the workloads with small random write intensive input output. Okay. So what are the benefits, which are the applications which benefit from RAID 1 plus 0? That is nothing but high transaction rate, online transaction processing, large messaging installations, database applications with the write intensive random access workloads. So please note that RAID 1 plus 0 and RAID 0 plus 1 are not the same. Okay. So RAID 1 plus 0, we also call it as striped mirror. So the basic element of RAID 1 plus 0 is the mirrored pair. That means what? Data is first mirrored and then both copies of the data are stripped across multiple disk drive pairs in a RAID set. When replacing a failed drive, only the mirror is rebuilt. So that means what? The disk array controller uses the surviving drive in the mirrored pair for data recovery and continuous operation. So you can observe that. Okay, so data from the surviving disk is copied to the replacement disk. So for example, let us take an example of six disk forming RAID 1 plus 0. That is what? RAID 1 first followed by RAID 0. Okay, these six disks are paired into, we have three sets, okay, of two disks. Three sets of two disk. So you can see here, okay, so data is stripped across all the three mirrored sets to form RAID 0. That means what? We are having three sets of two disk, correct? So each set acts as the RAID 1 set, okay, that is a mirrored pair of disk. So data is then stripped across all the three mirrored set to form RAID 0. So first it is stripping, then it is mirroring, correct? No. So what are the steps performed? So first see, can you see that drive RAID 1 plus 2, okay, say mirror set A. Okay, next is so you can observe here, okay, this diagram. Okay, next is drive 3 plus 4, okay, that is RAID again mirror set B, and drive 5 plus 6 will serve as the third set, mirror set C. Okay, so after this, now RAID 0 stripping is performed. Okay, first you can see that first mirroring, then stripping. Okay, so RAID 0 stripping is performed across the set number A, this is set B, the third one is set C. So if the drive, say for example, if the drive number 5 fails, then what will happen? The mirror set C, okay, this is 1, 2, 3, 4, this is the fifth one. So suppose, assume that the fifth one fails, what will happen? The mirror set C alone is affected. Okay, it still has a drive number 6 and continues to function, and the entire RAID 1 plus 0 array also keeps functioning. Suppose the drive number 3 fails, okay, while drive 5 is being replaced, then what will happen? The array still continues to function because drive 3 is in a different mirrored set. You can see this is drive 3, this is drive number 5. So we have two different sets. So naturally there is no problem. Okay, the performance, operation continues. That means what? Up to three drives can fail without affecting the array, as long as they are all in different mirror sets. Okay, so that is the one point you have to remember. So this is all about RAID 1 plus 0. Okay. Fine. Now what about RAID 0 plus 1? Please note that it is very important. Nested RAID. We have two types, RAID 1 plus 0. Now the right hand side diagram, you can see here RAID 0 plus 1. Fine. So you can see here, first I will show RAID 1 plus 0. This is RAID 1 plus 0 mirroring followed by RAID stripping. This is RAID 1. Okay. Next is, you can see now RAID 0. Fine. Okay, so this is the diagram for RAID 1 plus 0. First stripping, okay, then mirroring. Okay, before going to parity, let us finish RAID 0 plus 1. Okay, RAID 0 plus 1 we also call as mirrored stripe, already mentioned. So what is the basic element is a stripe. That means what? The process of striping the data across disk drives is performed initially. Then the entire stripe is mirrored. So in this configuration, suppose if one drive fails, the entire stripe is faulted. So that is the point. Okay, if one drive fails, entire stripe is going to be faulted. So consider the same example previous, okay, six disk to understand this. That means what? RAID 0 first, then RAID 1. So six disks are paired into two sets of three disks each. Each of the three these sets in turn acts as a RAID 0 set that contains three disks, and then these two sets are mirrored, okay, to form RAID level 1. So what are the steps performed in RAID 0 plus 1? That is RAID 1 plus 2 plus 3. It is nothing but a stripe set A. Next, drive 4 plus 5 plus 6. You can observe the diagram here. Okay, RAID 0 plus 1. Okay, this is RAID. You can see that this is your. Okay, this is your RAID 0 plus 1. So I am having two sets, drive 1 plus 2 plus 3, another one drive 4 plus 5 plus 6. So I have two stripes, correct now. So that is now mirrored, correct now. So that is RAID 0 plus 1 mirrored stripe. First you are having the copy of this, correct now. First entire the process of striping the data across the disk drive is performed initially, correct? Then the entire stripe is, you can observe first it is striped here, okay, this becomes a stripe, then correct? No, so that is duplicate of that, correct? So mirroring is done. Okay, so okay, so that is okay. So that means what? That we have, I am having two stripe sets, so these are going to be mirrored. Okay, if one of the drives, say drive number 3 fails, the entire stripe set A fails. Okay, so a rebuild operation copies the entire stripe, copying the data from each disk in the healthy stripe to an equivalent disk in the failed stripe. So that is, this will cause increased IO operations. Okay, and it makes the RAID set vulnerable to a second disk failure. Okay, so now after having studied this, now let me show you the third one called as the RAID redundancy. That is nothing but RAID level 3. Okay. So RAID level 3. First RAID 0, RAID 1. We have nested RAID. Now it is RAID level 3. This is simple. RAID level 3. It stripes the data for performance and it uses parity. Already I told what is parity for fault tolerance. Okay, so parity information will be stored on a dedicated drive so that data can be reconstructed if a drive fails in a RAID set. For example, in a say set of 5 disks, 4 are used for data. Okay, the 5th one is used for parity. You can see that. first four are for data disk, the fifth one is the, you know, the it is nothing but parity. So the total disk space some required will be 1.25 times the size of the data disk, because we need extra space. So naturally that disk space required is say 1.25 times the size of the data disk. So RAID 3 always reads and writes complete stripes of the data across all the disk, because the drives operate in parallel. So that is the small difference between RAID level 3 and RAID level 4. I will tell that. So in the case of RAID level 3, okay, the read and write operations, okay, will be done, correct, no? In parallel, correct, no? So read and writes complete stripes of the data across all the disk. So that means what? There is no parallel writes that update one out of many stripes in a one out of many strips in a stripe. So where it is used, it provides good performance for applications that involve large sequential data access. Remember, okay, sequential data access such as data backup or video streaming. Okay, so this is the, you can see here, okay, the middle drive fails. Okay, you can see that. So you can, how it is written, 4 + 6, okay, plus question mark plus 7 = 18. So the, you know, how it is calculated, it is nothing but the value is calculated, you know, is nothing but 1. Okay, so the fifth disk is a parity disk. Okay, so so that is about the RAID level 3. Okay, RAID level 3. Okay, so please remember what is RAID level 3. Okay, it uses parity. Now what is the difference between RAID level 3 and RAID level 4? 4 is very similar to RAID 3. Okay, RAID 4 also stripes data for high performance and uses parity for improved fault tolerance. Remember, RAID level 3 and RAID level 4 are used for fault tolerance only. That means you are having, okay, one dedicated drive, okay, for parity information. So data is striped across all the disks except the parity disk in the array, and the parity information will be stored in a dedicated disk so that the data can be rebuilt if a drive fails. So that is same. Okay, so the data, you know, data will be striped across all the disk except the parity disk. Okay, parity information will be stored on a dedicated disk. Okay, so that is as same as RAID level 3. But what is the difference between then RAID level 3 and RAID level 4? Fine. So RAID level 3, the data disk in RAID 4, in RAID level 3, you can see that the data read or write is done across the entire stripe. But in case of RAID level 4, the data disk in RAID 4 can be accessed independently, so that the specific data elements can be read or, so this is RAID level 3, okay, RAID level 3, the fifth one is a parity disk. You can see here the first four are the data disk, fifth one is a parity disk. Okay, so what is the difference between then RAID level 3 and RAID level 4? Okay, only difference is that data disk in RAID 4 can be accessed independently, so that the specific data elements can be read or written on a single disk without reading or writing the entire stripe. So that is the only difference between the RAID level 3 and RAID level 4. Okay, in RAID level 3, no partial writing that update one out of many strips in a stripe. Okay, but whereas in RAID level 4, okay, the data can be accessed, okay, I mean data disk in RAID 4 can be accessed independently. Okay, so that means the data elements can be read or written on a single disk without reading or writing an entire stripe. Okay, so that's a small difference. So, but this also provides good read throughput and reasonable write throughput. Okay, so that is the difference between RAID 3 and RAID 4. Okay, so both uses a data disk and one separate dedicated parity disk. Only major some difference is that, correct? No? So the way in which data can be accessed. Okay, so in case of RAID level 3, okay, so it reads and writes complete stripes of the data across all the disk. Okay, that is because all the drives operate in parallel. Okay, whereas in RAID level 4, the individual data disk can be accessed independently, but in RAID level 3 that option is not there. Okay, so all the data read and write all the stripes of data at a time. Okay, so no independently accessing the data disk is not possible in RAID level 3, but that is available, or that option is there in RAID level 4. So that is the small difference between 3 and 4. But so 3 and 4 uses a dedicated parity disk. Now the last one, again, this is RAID 3. Already I showed you RAID level 3. Now RAID level 5 and 6. Again, like RAID level 3 and RAID level 4, we have a small difference between RAID level 5 and 6. What is RAID level 5? Again, RAID level 5 is very similar to RAID level 4, except that the parity is it is very similar to RAID 4. Why? Because it uses striping. Okay, RAID level 5 also uses striping only. Okay, and data drives are independently accessible. So in that meaning, okay, RAID level 5 is very similar to RAID level 4. Okay, because it uses striping. You can see in the diagram what I have shown. Okay, it uses the striping only. Okay, and the drives, the strips are independently accessible. Okay, then what is the difference then RAID level 4 and RAID level 5? Okay, so that is the parity location. Okay, so this diagram carefully, parity generated. Okay, so then you will ask what is the difference between RAID level 5 and RAID level 4. Why? Because both are using striping technique. So the difference, what difference is nothing but the parity location. Difference is parity location. That means what, in RAID level 4, parity is written to a dedicated drive, creating a right bottleneck for the parity disk. You have a dedicated parity disk, but in case of RAID 5, parity is distributed across all the data disk to overcome the right bottleneck of a dedicated parity disk. So in case of RAID level 5, there is no dedicated parity disk is there. Then how? Then the parity is distributed across all the data disk. Okay, so why? To overcome the bottleneck of a dedicated, that is right bottleneck of a dedicated parity disk. So you can see this diagram. Okay, see, this is I don't have a separate dedicated parity disk, but the parity information is distributed. You can see here A1, B1, C1, D1. Then you can see, okay, the you have five different disk. Okay, so here next is A2, B2, C2. Then in the fourth location you have parity data. Okay, here in the fifth location I have the parity data. Here is in the fourth location, here third location, second location, first location. That means what, the parity is distributed across all the data disk only. Okay, there is no, you can see from the diagram, there is no dedicated parity disk. Please remember, very important. Okay, so RAID level 0 is a striping technique. RAID level 1 uses mirroring technique. Nested RAID, you combines RAID level 1, RAID level 0, either RAID 1 plus 0 or RAID 0 plus 1. But RAID, next is the RAID level 3 we discussed. RAID level 3 uses parity, okay? RAID level 3, even RAID level 4 also uses a parity disk. Okay, it uses a parity concept, fault tolerance. But difference between RAID level 3 and RAID level 4 is nothing but the, you know, how the way in which data is accessed. Okay, in case of RAID level 3, okay, no independent accessing, but in case of RAID level 4, data disk can be accessed independently. Okay, now coming to RAID level 5 and RAID level 6, okay, there is no dedicated parity disk. Okay, you can see that from the diagram. Okay, the only I have 5 data disk, the parity information is distributed across the data disk. Fine, you can observe from here, carefully observe here. Okay, so the 5 data disk here, parity information here, also the parity information here, parity information. No dedicated parity drive. Okay, so reduces the why it is used to overcome the right bottleneck of a dedicated parity disk. Then the last one, so when it is where it is used, RAID level 5 is good for random read intensive IO applications and preferred for messaging, data mining, and medium performance media serving and RDBMS implementations. Now last one is RAID level 6. Again, it also very similar to RAID level 5. There is no dedicated parity disk, see from the diagram. But you can see that RAID 6, carefully see the diagram, RAID level 6 includes second parity element to enable survival if two disk failures occur in a RAID set. You can see that, see the diagram. Okay, so there are two parity information. Okay, second parity element. Here also you can observe your first parity element, second parity element. See the fourth row, fourth column, first parity element, second parity element. Here also you can observe here. Okay, first parity element, second parity element. That means what? It includes a second parity element to enable survival if two disk failures occur. Therefore, what is a constraint is that it requires at least 4 disk. Okay, the RAID 6 distributes the parity across all the disk. The RAID penalty is more than in RAID 5. So RAID 5 writes perform better than RAID level 6. Okay, the rebuild operation in RAID level 6 takes a longer time. Why? Because due to the presence of two parity sets. So only difference between RAID level 5 and RAID level 6 is that RAID level 6 have two parity sets. Okay, whereas RAID level 5 uses a single parity element. But again, there is no dedicated parity disk in both RAID 5 as well as RAID 6. So these are the RAID levels. Okay, please go through this, very important it is. RAID level, various RAID levels, RAID level 0, RAID level 1, nested RAID, next RAID level 3 and RAID level 4 are very similar. RAID level 5 and RAID level 6 are very similar. Okay, please go through these PPTs as well as the e-materials to note down the concepts of the RAID techniques. Now comparisons, quickly we go through the comparisons. Okay, so RAID level 0, minimum disk, storage efficiency, cost, read performance, write performance, write penalty. Okay, write penalty. So in case of RAID level 0, minimum disk 2, storage efficiency 100%, cost is low, read performance very good for both random as well as sequential read. Write performance good, write penalty no. RAID level 1, minimum disk 2, storage efficiency 50. Why? Because it uses I told mirroring technique, correct? No, so storage efficiency is less, cost is high, read performance good, read performance better than single disk. Okay, whereas write performance slower than single disk. Whereas the RAID level 3, okay, minimum disk 3, you can see the storage efficiency formula. Okay, then cost also you can see moderate. Okay, similarly read performance and write performance. RAID level 5, RAID level 4, okay, minimum disk 3, cost is moderate. RAID level 5, okay, again minimum disk 3, cost is moderate. RAID level 6, minimum disk is 4, okay, cost is moderate but more than RAID level 5. Okay, see, and please go through this table, it is there in your textbook. Okay, RAID comparisons. Okay, RAID impact on the performance. Okay, so it is very important to consider the impact on the disk performance and application. Okay, so in both mirrored and parity RAID configuration, every write operation translates into more input output overhead for the disk, which is we referred as a write penalty. Okay, in a RAID 1 implementation, every write operation must be performed on two disks configured as a mirrored pair, whereas in RAID level 5 implementation, a write operation may manifest as 4 IO operations. Then performing IOs to a disk configured with the RAID level 5, okay, controller has to read, recalculate and write a parity segment for every data write operation. Okay, so that is a little thing we have to remember. Okay, parity versus mirroring. Okay, reading, calculating and writing parity segment introduces penalty to every write operation, and parity RAID penalty manifests due to slower cache flushes. So increased load in RAIDs can cause contention and can cause slower RAID response times. Okay, now that is about the little bit on the RAID impacts on the performance. Okay, you can see this. Okay, this is okay. Now we are will be going to the next chapter called intelligent storage systems. Okay, so please remember we are still in module number 1. Okay, I told module number 1 having 4 chapters: chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3 and chapter number 4. So chapter number 4 we are going to start called as intelligent storage systems. So what are the we are going to learn here? Okay, describe the components of intelligent storage system, benefits and the algorithms, cache algorithms and protection, and how to intelligent storage array implementation, high end storage array, mid range storage array. Okay, so before that, okay, so small introduction to intelligent storage system. Okay, you say as we have mentioned earlier, okay, the business critical applications require high level of performance, availability, security and scalability. So what is a disk drive? It is a, you know, that is a core element of storage that governs the performance of any storage system, correct? No, so we have many disk array technologies. Okay, they may not overcome the performance constraints due to the limitations of disk drive and their mechanical components. So already we have gone through one technology called RAID technology. Even with the RAID implementation, okay, it may not be able to meet the performance requirements of today's applications, correct? No, so the applications require high availability, performance, security and scalability, the four major factors: performance, scalability, availability and security. Okay, even with the RAID technology also, okay, we may not meet the performance requirements. So we are going to go through a new breed of storage solution called as intelligent storage systems. Okay, so they are okay, so we have benefits are there. So they are a feature rich RAID array that provide highly optimized IO processing capabilities. So these storage systems are configured with large amount of memory, remember. So this is what we call as called cache, and multiple IO paths, and use sophisticated algorithms to meet the requirements of performance sensitive applications. These arrays will have an high have an operating environment that intelligently and optimally handles the management, allocation and utilization of storage resources. Okay, so we have to learn in this chapter. Okay, so the benefits of intelligent storage system, its benefits, its components, and some of the algorithms. Okay, so so what is the intelligent storage system? Okay, they are also RAID arrays, but they are highly optimized for IO processing. Okay, have large amount of cache. Okay, for improving IO performance. Okay, and have operating environment which can provide intelligence for managing the cache, array resource allocation, connectivity for heterogeneous host, and advanced array based local and remote replication options. So we are going to learn the intelligent storage systems. Okay, so what are the benefits of intelligent storage system? Okay, increased capacity, improved performance, easier data management, improved data availability and protection, enhanced business continuity support, improved security and access control. These are the some of the benefits. Having learned the benefits, now we are going to go through the next important topic called as components of intelligent storage system. We can see that it consists of four key components. Number one, please make a point, front end. The second one is called cache. The third one is called back end. And fourth one, physical disk. As you can see from the diagram, okay. So the connections you can see, the interconnections you can see in the diagram. Okay, so four major components, front end, cache, back end, and physical disk. Fine. So of course you have other side, the host, and the connectivity is there. I told the key data center elements is the same thing, correct? No? So we have the beginning classes, we discussed it, what are the core elements of data center. We have application, we have DBMS, we have host or compute, we have network, nothing but connectivity, and storage. Okay, now the question is, what is this the four major components? Okay, so we'll discuss in detail. So you can see here, an IO request received from the host at the front end port is processed through cache and back end to enable storage and retrieval of the data from the physical disk. Okay, so a read request can be serviced directly from the cache if the requested data is found in the cache. So in the modern intelligent storage system, front end, cache, back end are typically integrated on a single board, generally referred as storage processor or storage controller. Okay, generally you can see the diagram. Okay, the front end, back cache, and back end are generally integrated on a single board. Fine. Okay, so you can see that the front end is having, okay, let us discuss in detail now. Okay, so this is the you can see here IO request coming from the host. You have the front end controllers, okay, and the okay, IO processing order. Okay, this is a cylinder. Okay, this is without optimization. With command queuing, IO request, you can see here front end controller, IO processing order. Okay, cylinders. Now this is about to, you know, with command queue. Okay, this is first in, first out. Okay, now what is the front end. Now the four components we are going to study. Okay, then we'll learn the concept of how to do the write operation, how to do the read operation. We'll study later. So before that, the four major components called as front end. So what is front end? So it can be an important question. Intelligent storage system. Okay, what are the four major components? Okay, remember this. Okay, front end, cache, back end, and physical disk. So first one, front end. So the front end provides interface between the storage system and the host. You can see from the diagram. The front end provides the interface between the storage system and the host. It consists of two components. They call it as front end port and front end controllers. Okay, a front end has redundant controllers for high availability. You can see that it has redundant duplicate controllers, okay, for high availability. And each controller contains, you can see that, multiple ports that enable larger numbers of the host to connect to the intelligent storage system. So you can see that there are duplicate set of the front end controller, okay, which in turn contain multiple port. You can see the diagram, okay, which enable large number of the host to connect to the intelligent storage system. Fine. Each front end controller has a processing logic that executes the appropriate transport protocol, say such as a fiber channel or SSCSI, okay, for storage connections. So what is the job of the front end controller? It has the processing logic that executes the appropriate transport protocol. So the front end controllers, what it will do, it routes the data to and from the cache. You can see in the diagram, okay, the front end controllers route the data to and from the cache via internal data bus. So when the cache receives the write data, the controller sends acknowledgement message back to the host. So this is the job of the front end controller. So it routes the data to and from the host via the internal data bus. Fine. So when the cache receives the write data, what it will do, it will send acknowledgement back to the host. So this is about the front end. So the front end has two things, the port and the controllers. Okay, so what is the job of the front end controller? It is executes, okay, it has the processing logic that executes the appropriate transport protocol. Now the next is what is called as the cache. Okay, the second component is called the cache. What is this? It is a semiconductor memory where data is placed temporarily to reduce the time required to service the IO request directly from the host. Right now, so why the data is stored temporarily in this cache? Why? To reduce what the time required to service the request coming from the host. So it will improve the storage system performance by isolating the host from mechanical delays associated with the rotating disk or hard disk drives. So naturally, what is the major advantage is that it improves performance, because we are very much interested in the performance factor. Okay, so by isolating the host from the mechanical delay, okay, because you know the rotating disk are the slowest component of the intelligent storage system. So it takes several milliseconds because of the seek time and rotational latency. So naturally, what will happen, the data transfer will be delayed. So to avoid this, what it will done, okay, the data is stored in a temporary memory. We call it as cache memory, because accessing the data from the cache is fast. It takes less than a millisecond. Okay, so in case of the intelligent arrays, the write data is first placed in the cache, then returned to the disk. Okay, so this is the second component of the intelligent storage system called as cache. The first one is the front end, next one is the cache. Fine. Now, what is the structure of okay, before directly going to the we have to study in detail the regarding the cache. So I told front end, I told what is cache. Okay, now let me also tell about the back end. Let me quickly do that. Okay, what is back end? So back end provides, you can see from the diagram, it provides interface between the cache and the physical disk. Okay, it consists of again two components, back end port and back end controllers. Like the front end port and front end controllers, back end has back end port and back end controllers. So it the back end controls data transfers between the cache and the physical disk. From cache, the data is sent to the back end and then routed to the destination disk. The physical disk are connected to the ports on the back end. Okay, the back end controller communicates with the disk when performing read and write and provides additional but of course limited temporary data storage. The algorithms implemented on the back end controllers provide error detection and correction along with the read functionality. So like the front end, we have back end port and back end controllers which is connected to the physical disk. Fine. So for high data protection and high availability, storage systems are configured with dual controllers with the multiple ports. So such configurations provide alternative path to the physical disk if a controller or port failure occurs. So this reliability is further enhanced if the disk are also dual ported. So in such a case, each disk port can connect to a separate controller. So multiple controllers will facilitate load balancing. So that is about the back end. Of course, the last one called as physical disk. Physical disk are connected to the back end storage controller. You see the diagram and provide persistent data storage. You know, persistent, not like the cache storage, persistent data storage. Okay. So they provide modern intelligent storage system provide support for variety of disk drives with a different speed and types. For example, FC, we have SATA, okay, flash drives, etc. So that is about physical disk. Anyway, so these are the four major components of what is called as the intelligent storage system. Very important: front end, back end, cache, and physical disk. See the diagram. Okay, so this is the four things. Fine. Now we are going to study what is called as the cache. The very important next one is called as the related to cache. Okay, because front end, next is back end, and of course physical disk. But the important component is here the cache. So we have to discuss in detail. Okay, the structure of the cache. Okay, so this is we will study later. Okay. Structure of the cache. Okay, now the next topic, I told after studying the four components, we are going to discuss in detail the structure of the cache, then read and write operation, how to do with the cache, and the cache implementation, and cache management, and cache data protection. So these are the topics we have to discuss in detail. The first of the topic is the structure of the cache. Fine. So you can see here, okay, the cache contains or is organized into pages, okay, which is the smallest unit of cache allocation. The size of the cache page is configured according to the application IO size. the cache consists of data store and the tag RAM. You can see from the diagram. Okay, I hope you can see the diagram. So cache is organized into pages. Okay, it consists of data store and the tag RAM. Okay, the data store holds the data, whereas the tag RAM tracks the location of the data in the data store and as well as in the disk. Okay, so that is the structure of the cache. So cache is organized into pages and it contains a data store as well as tag RAM. Data store holds the data, and the tag RAM tracks the location of the data in the data store, fine, and as well as in the disk. Okay, the entries in the tag RAM, okay, indicate where the data is cached and where the data belongs on the disk. Okay, it also includes a flag called as a dirty bit flag, which indicates whether the data in the cache has been committed to the disk. Okay, it also contains the time-based information such as the time of the last access, which is used to identify the cached information that has not been accessed for a long period and may be freed up. Okay, so a tag RAM includes what is called as the dirty bit flag, which indicates whether the data in the cache has been committed to the disk. It also contains time-based information. Okay. Now, with that introduction, we are going to study what is called as a read operation with the cache. Read operation with the cache. This is about the write operation. We'll see it later. Okay. This is the write actually, write operation. So first is the read operation. See, when a host issues a read request, what will happen? I'll see the diagram parallelly. Okay, when a read operation with the cache. Okay, we discussed the four components of intelligent storage system: front end, back end, cache, and physical disk. Now the we are going to concentrate on the cache. So first I showed you the structure of the cache. Now we are going to discuss in detail read operation and write operation. So when first is read operation. So when a host issues a read request, what will happen? The storage controller reads the tag RAM. Okay, already I told what is tag RAM. Okay, to determine whether the required data is available in the cache. If the requested data is, you can see the diagram parallelly. If the requested data is found in the cache, it is called read cache hit. If the requested data is available in the cache, it is called read cache hit, or also called as a read hit, and data is sent directly to the host without any disk operation. I hope you can see the diagram. So this provides a fast response time to the host, about a millisecond. But now the second case, if the requested data is not found in the if the requested data is not found in the cache, what will happen? We call them as a cache miss. See, this first one is read hit, now is a cache miss, and data must be read from the disk. Now I hope it is very simple. If the requested data is found in the cache, we call it as read hit or cache hit, read cache hit. But if the data is not available in the cache, we call it as a cache miss, and data must be read from the disk. So what will happen? The back end will access the appropriate disk, not front end. Back end will access the appropriate disk and retrieves the requested data. Then the data is placed in the cache and finally sent back to the host through the front end. You can remember the diagram. First, on the left side, we have the first diagram I showed you. here front end, next cache, next back end, physical disk, correct? No, so the first read, if the when a read request when the host issues read request, okay, the storage controller reads the tag RAM, okay, to determine whether the required data is available in the cache. If it is available, we call it as a read hit. If it is not available, data should be read from the disk, and backend will do it. Backend will access the appropriate disk and retrieve the data, and it will be placed in the cache and finally sent back to the host. So this is about the read. So cache misses increase the IO response time. Okay, so one is a read hit, or also called as read cache hit, and the second thing is that cache miss if the data is not found in the cache. You can see the diagram. Anyway, this is write operation, right? Read operation first. The second one you see, cache miss. So the data should be accessed from the physical disk. Fine. This is about the read operation. So a free fetch or read ahead algorithm is used when read requests are sequential. In a sequential read request, a contiguous set of associated blocks is retrieved. Several other blocks that have not yet been requested by the host can be read from the disk and placed into cache in advance. When the host subsequently requests these blocks, the read operations will be read hits. This process improves the response time experienced by the host. Okay, the intelligent storage system offers, they call it as free fix and variable free fetch size. The first one is called fixed free fetch. Free fetch. So here the intelligent storage system free fetches a fixed amount of data. It is most suitable when the host IO sizes are uniform. Whereas in variable free fetch, the storage system free fetches an amount of the data in multiple of the size of the host request. So we have remember, okay, we called as a free fetch here. Free fetch algorithm is used when read requests are sequential. There are two types. We have fixed free fetch and variable free fetch. In fixed free fetch, okay, the intelligent storage system free fetches fixed amount of data. In variable free fetch, storage system free fetches amount of the data in multiples of the size of the host request. The maximum free fetch limits, okay, the number of data blocks that can be free fetched to prevent the disk from being rendered busy with the free fetch at the expense of other IO operation. Okay, so we call that term as a maximum free fetch limit. That is, so this is about the read operation. So generally, read performance is measured in terms of read hit ratio or hit rate. Okay, generally expressed as percentage. Okay, this ratio is nothing but the number of read hits with respect to the total number of read request. Fine. The higher read hit ratio will improve the read performance. So this is about the read operation with the cache. So first we discussed what is the cache, what is the structure of the cache. I showed you the diagram. Now two major operations called read operation and write operation. Read operation with the cache, I told, okay, one possibility is read cache hit. The second possibility is cache miss. Now come back to the next one called as a write operation with the cache. Fine. Write operation with the cache. Okay, remember these are all important. Okay, the write operation with the cache provides performance advantages over writing directly to the disk. When an IO is written, input output is written to the cache and acknowledged, it is completed in far less time from the host's perspective than it would take to write directly to the disk. Sequential writes offer opportunities for optimization because many smaller writes can be collected for larger transfers to the disk drives. So there are two different methods. We call it as a write back cache and write. You can see a write request. Write back and write through cache. In case of read, I told we have two things are there. Data is found in the cache, we call it as read hit. Data is not found in the cache, we call it as read miss. Read hit or read miss are also called as cache miss. Fine. Now write operation, there are two types. Okay, write back cache, write through cache. What is write back cache? See the diagram. Okay, data is placed in the cache. Okay, first one is I am discussing write back here. Okay, data is placed in the cache. You can see the diagram. This is the first one. Second one, no. Okay. Okay, see that second one diagram, below diagram, data is placed in the cache and immediately data is placed in the cache and acknowledgement is sent to the host immediately. You can see the diagram. Later data from several writes are committed to the disk. So write response times are much faster because write operations are isolated from the mechanical delay of the disk. But uncommitted data is at the risk of the loss if the cache failures occur. So this is about write back. Data is placed in the cache and acknowledgement is sent to the host immediately. Later stage, data from the several writes are committed to the disk. Now the first one, the first diagram if you see here carefully, okay, write through cache. What happens here? Data is placed in a cache and immediately returned to the disk. Fine. Data is placed in the cache, immediately returned to the disk. Then acknowledgement is sent to the host. So because the that means what? Data is committed to the disk as it arrives. So the risk of data loss is low, but write response time is longer. So there is a major difference between write back and write through. In case of write back, okay, data is placed in the cache, immediately returned to the disk. So no question of risk, no question of data loss. But in case of write through cache, data is placed in the cache and a acknowledgement is sent to the host in return. And data is, okay, at the later stage, the several writes are committed to the disk. That means what? In case of write back, okay, first data is stored in the cache. So at a later stage, a number of writes will take place. But in case of write through cache, it is step by step. Every as the data is placed in the cache, immediately it is returned to the disk. Correct. Now, so the risk of data loss is less. So this is the two major operations. Please remember. So cache, the four types of the components, okay, front end, back end, cache, and what is called the physical disk. The next operations we discussed the structure of the cache, read operation with the cache, either two possibilities, either read hit or read miss. Write operation with the cache, through two types, write through, write back. This is write through cache, but if you see write back, this is read operation. Now coming to cache implementation. Okay, cache can be implemented as either dedicated cache or global cache. Fine. With the dedicated cache, separate set of the memory locations are reserved for read and write. But in the global cache, both read and write can use any of the available memory addresses. So cache management is more efficient in a global cache implementation because only one global set of addresses has to be managed. So the global cache allows the users to specify percentage of the cache available for read and write for cache management. So typically the read cache is small, but it should be increased if the application being used is read intensive. So that is about cache implementation, either as a local dedicated cache or a global cache. So that means what? Dedicated cache, separate set of the memory location are reserved for read and write. But in global cache, read and write can use any of the available memory addresses. Now the next topic, okay, little bit we'll go through that called cache management. We have, you know, cache is a finite and expensive resource that needs proper management. Even though modern intelligent storage systems come with large amount of cache, okay, when all the cache pages are filled, some pages have to be freed up to accommodate new data and avoid performance degradation. Okay, definitely we require paging technologies. Some pages have to be freed up. Fine. So various cache management algorithms are implemented in the intelligent storage system. Okay, to proactively maintain a set of free pages and the list of the pages that can be potentially freed up whenever required. So what are the two commonly used algorithms? You are aware of this. Number one is called least recently used. The second one is called the most recently used. First one is called least recently used, LRU. What is this? An algorithm that continuously monitors the data access in the cache and identifies the cache pages that have not been accessed for a long time, least recently used. So LRU algorithm either frees up these pages or mark them as for reuse. Okay, that means what? Discards the least recently used data. So this algorithm is based on the assumption that data that has not been accessed for a while will not be requested by the host. If the page contains write data that has not yet been committed to disk, okay, data is first returned to the disk before the page is reused. So this is the one algorithm called least recently used, LRU algorithm. Okay, algorithm which continuously monitors the data access in the cache and identifies the cache pages that have not been accessed for a long time. Whereas the second one called as most recently used, MRU. This algorithm is nothing but it is the opposite of LRU, where the pages that have been accessed most recently are freed up or marked for reuse. There is a major difference. So this algorithm is based on the assumption that recently accessed data may not be required for a while. Okay. So the question is here. So that is about the cache. Okay. What is the cache? What is the structure of the cache? Read operation with the cache, write operation with the cache, the cache algorithms, management algorithms, LRU and MRU. But one more concept is that they call it as flushing, because you see, as the cache fills, the storage system must take action to flush dirty pages, that is nothing but data returned into the cache but not yet returned to the disk. This is called as dirty pages. Why this is required? To manage the space availability. So flushing is nothing but it is a process that commits data from the cache to the disk. So there is the concept of what you call as idle flushing, high watermark flushing and forced flushing. Okay so I think that will So we'll discuss in the next class. Okay, so today's class we discussed the RAID levels. Okay, RAID technologies. Please recall all these things: RAID technologies, stripping, mirroring, and parity. Then RAID levels: RAID level 0, RAID level 1, nested RAID, RAID level 3, 4, grade level 5 6. Then we discussed what is called as intelligent storage systems. In that one, the components of the intelligent storage system: front end, back end, cache and physical disk. Then we little bit discussed on cache, very important, the structure of the cache, read operation with the cache and write operation with the cache. Okay, so in the next class I'll discuss